It's 1927, and Mary Jones is on her way to the hospital. She'd had severe abdominal pain when menstruating, since puberty, and had just figured this was why everyone says their monthly curse is such a nightmare. And yes, that's a real slang people had for periods back in the day. But when she couldn't get pregnant, she knew it was time to get a doctor involved. When she gets to the hospital, her doctor performs an exploratory surgery to see if there's anything obviously abnormal or obstructive in her abdomen. And they find a bunch of unexpected tissue in there. It's scarred and hanging off her reproductive organs for reasons they couldn't explain. So Mary's doctor removes the weird extra tissue, and after the surgery, Mary is pain-free. Sadly, the doctor had to remove her ovaries along with all that mysterious tissue, so she wasn't able to have kids like she may have wanted. Her doctors really didn't know much about endometriosis back then, nor did anyone else, really. And honestly, we still don't know a lot about that diagnosis, despite decades of research in other areas. We made up Mary Jones. She's a fictional person based on the real experiences of countless people. And the thing is, we didn't have to make our theoretical patient a woman or assigned female at birth, because the weirdest thing about this uterine disease is that you don't need a uterus to get it. The problems associated with endometriosis all begin when tissue starts growing where it's not supposed to be. Most of the time, your liver tissue stays in the liver, bladder tissue stays in the bladder, and uterine tissue stays in the uterus. When your uterine tissue starts growing outside of the uterus, you have endometriosis, and it's not a good time. Not to be confused with wandering womb syndrome, which is not real, but is a thing that we have a pin of, and it's a cute little angry uterus. Endometriosis is named after the endometrial tissue from the uterus that goes rogue around your body. As you get more and more endometrial tissue accumulating in unexpected locations, it causes major problems, as you might imagine. These errant cells end up sending out signals that cause inflammation, resulting in the formation of lesions and causing abdominal pain that can be debilitating. On top of that, many people with endometriosis experience infertility. But the thing is, we don't know why or how your endometrial tissue left the uterus in the first place. And that's a mystery that experts have been mulling over for a century. In 1927, a researcher named John Sampson was one of the first to propose an explanation, arguing that endometriosis was caused by something called retrograde menstruation. His idea was, when some unlucky individuals get their period, their flow moves backwards through the fallopian tubes. In that process, it shuttles tissue out of the uterus where it can attach to other organs and start growing in new and unusual places. And according to this explanation, it only happens to some menstruating people because the junction where the fallopian tubes connect to the rest of the uterus has to be shaped just right or wrong to let that tissue through. There's also a correlation between endometriosis and patients with some kind of blockage in their menstrual machinery, which could then be pushing menstrual fluid out through the only other available exit. The retrograde menstruation hypothesis does make intuitive sense, but it's never really been confirmed. The true cause of endometriosis has been tricky to nail down, and that could be because endometriosis might not be one thing. It might be three things. In 1997, Michel Nizal and Jacques Denet proposed the idea that what we're calling endometriosis is actually three distinct diagnoses. One is based in the ovaries, one in the abdomen, and the last in either the rectum or vagina. They've based this idea on the fact that the three subgroupings of endometriosis result in tissue types that all look different. So if endometriosis is really three different diseases, we may have been looking for one smoking gun when we really needed three, which would explain why it's been so hard to figure out. And part of the problem may be that we were only looking for that smoking gun in a specific population of people, when we needed to broaden the search to a whole other group of people as well. The retrograde menstruation hypothesis only makes sense if everyone who has endometriosis menstruates, which is not true. One study looked at transmasculine patients at Boston Children's Hospital in various stages of transition, including some who'd started testosterone treatment. And testosterone usually stops your periods. They found that all seven who'd reported a history of painful periods before their transition had endometriosis. And a 2019 study on transmasculine adults who'd had hysterectomies found that of the 94 patients studied, 8 had endometriosis at the time of their surgery. Now, that doesn't immediately condemn the retrograde menstruation hypothesis, because those could have been transmasculine people who menstruate. The 2019 paper noted that 12 people included in the study had breakthrough menstruation while on testosterone therapy, but it didn't say whether any of those 12 were among the 8 with endometriosis. And that doesn't explain why cis women with no uteruses would have endometriosis either. If you were assigned female at birth, you could be one in roughly 4,500 people diagnosed with MRKH syndrome, a condition where people are born without a uterus, cervix, or vagina, but do have ovaries. So you'd think, no uterus, no endometriosis, right? Nope. These people can totally still have it too. Okay, so that's strike 2 on the retrograde menstruation idea. Or it was until researchers looked a bit closer. Turns out that a lot of people diagnosed with MRKH syndrome have something called a rudimentary uterus. Although studies vary on how common this is, it seems like at least half of MRKH patients have one. So you could have a little piece of uterine tissue that never developed into a fully functional uterus, but there's still something there. And that turns out to be a really important distinction across MRKH cases. A meta-analysis demonstrated that all of the people with MRKH syndrome and endometriosis have at least a little bit of uterus, which might be where that rogue tissue started its journey, which means we're back supporting retrograde menstruation. Except sometimes cis men have endometriosis too. There are 17 published case studies of cis men with endometriosis as of 2024, which couldn't be the result of retrograde menstruation because they don't have menstrual equipment. And we're pretty sure they checked this time. One alternate explanation has to do with hormones. See, a lot of the men who've been diagnosed with endometriosis had been on estrogen therapy to treat prostate cancer. So maybe long-term exposure to estrogen can activate something in their bodies to develop endometriosis. And to explain how that could happen, we need to go way back to when you were a fetus. So back in the good old days when you were a fetus, your whole body was pretty much a blank slate. You had all of these stem cells that could become an eyeball or a kidney or whatever, depending on the hormones and other factors they're exposed to. So there was a point in your development where some of your cells could have specialized into either ovaries and a uterus, or testicles and a penis, along with the other associated bits for each. This means that at one point in time, everybody had cells that could have become a uterus. Most of the time, any extra cells that didn't get used up making those organs end up withering away and getting recycled. But this new endometriosis hypothesis suggests that the leftover would-be uterine cells might stow away in your body, and this wouldn't be an issue unless they were exposed to extra estrogen, which would cause them to start growing. Suddenly, you're a cis man with endometrial tissue. It's plausible enough, but not all of the men with endometriosis had been on estrogen therapy. There have been at least 2 case reports of cis men who'd never been on estrogen therapy and still got endometriosis anyway, which isn't a lot, but it's weird that it happened twice. So it was back to the drawing board, and to come up with a new explanation, researchers turned to a very old hypothesis, first put forth in 1919 by Robert Meyer. The idea was that sometimes cells of one type might just turn into another, even in adults who are way past the fetal development stage. He called this transition metaplasia. In the case of endometriosis, this would mean that some of the mesothelial cells that cover your testes could turn into endometrial cells. In the metaplasia hypothesis for endometriosis, you wouldn't need extra estrogen to kick off the cellular switcheroo. Instead, the trigger would be inflammation. Something like a surgery kicks your immune system into hyperdrive, and all the resulting inflammation could aggravate those cells and spin them up into endometriosis. I know. That sounds made up, but in 2013, there was a case report of another cis man with endometriosis. His cells had the characteristic estrogen receptors that endometriosis usually has, but they also had markers for mesothelial cells. Those mesothelial markers were probably left over from when the cells were mesothelial before metaplasia happened. At this point, it kind of feels like we have too many hypotheses for what's causing endometriosis, which isn't as bad as having too few, but also means means we are a long ways off from solving the whole puzzle. At the end of the day, even though it's one of the most common gynecological conditions humans face, we still don't really know what causes endometriosis. Retrograde menstruation is still the most accepted explanation for how most people get endometriosis, but now we know that it's literally impossible for that to apply to everybody with this disease. So researchers may have been onto something when they suggested that maybe it can happen in more than one way, or maybe we're really talking about more than one diagnosis. Endometriosis is complicated, and it affects 11% of cis women, plus those 17 cis men and counting. And with so many people getting this diagnosis every day, research has ramped up exponentially since the first publication in the 1920s. We're way better at diagnosing it now, too. These days, you can often get an idea of what's going on through laparoscopy, ultrasounds, and MRIs, so major surgery doesn't have to be the first step in diagnosis like it was for Mary Jones. And once you get a diagnosis, we have a lot more ways to treat this condition than we used to. There's hormonal contraceptives, which regulate your hormones and can stop menstruation, so there's nothing to retrograde up into the fallopian tubes. And while Mary Jones wasn't able to get pregnant, nowadays most people with endometriosis can still get pregnant through methods like IVF. There's clearly a long way to go when it comes to treating endometriosis, or even like understanding it fully, but research is always ongoing, and new treatments are always around the corner. If these case studies tell you anything, it's that scientists are good at updating their views with new evidence. When new publications poke holes in one hypothesis, that's how we form hypotheses that explain even more about a condition. And with enough time, we might experience the end of endometriosis.